So we are in the last part of our securities valuation curriculum, that is equity valuation. We have completed bond valuation, bond price, bond yield, the bond risk, and how these bonds are rated, and how we get the duration of the bond, convexity of the bond, how we can get the price fluctuations with regard to bonds when the price fluctuation yield is given. And then we have seen bond portfolio management strategies, immunization strategy or ROIC analysis, all that we have seen in bond portfolio management. So now we are in the last part of our curriculum, that is equity valuation. So all of us know bond and equity are very important financial instruments for enhancing the investor's return with a minimum risk. If the, these are all, we call it financial assets, bonds and equities. So now we are the second part of our curriculum, is equity valuation. When you talk about equity valuation, valuing equity is very, very difficult task for any investor, because equities do not have definite life, definite maturity period. Since an equity does not have a definite maturity period, it is very difficult to value these equity shares. Nevertheless, we have come out with a lot of approaches and models recent times to value the equity shares. Stock valuation is more difficult than bond valuation, because stocks are, do not have a finite maturity, and future cash flow dividends are not specified, because dividend payment is not compulsory on the part of the company. We have various approaches for stock valuation. They are balance sheet valuation, dividend discount model, price earning method, that we call price earning ratio, and CAPM model, capital asset pricing model, that we have seen in portfolio management. So we will take up one by one. First, we'll take up the balance sheet valuation. Based on balance sheet, we can value the equity shares. So based on balance sheet, there are three measures given to value the equity shares. They are book value per share, or we call it intrinsic value per share, liquidation value per share, or replacement value per share, that we will see one by one. These are all very theoretical approach, so we don't have any case study to solve all this. But this book value, liquidation value, all that we have seen earlier in different discussions in portfolio management course, or which strategy financial management course, we have seen all this. So first we'll take up book value per share, or intrinsic value per share. Book value per share is calculated based on balance sheet of a company. So the most common method of valuing the equity share, it is very simple method for valuation. So how do we get book value? Take the balance sheet, and when you take the balance sheet, liability side, you find share capital, reserves and surplus, secured loans, unsecured loans, current liabilities and provisions. The asset side, we find fixed assets, investments, current assets, loans, advances, the miscellaneous expenditure. So here, yeah. So here, we need to get the share capital, that is the on the balance sheet liability side, the reserves and surplus, that is a bonus equity, or then you can what is that? Take the all the bonus equity, that is the word, divide by the total number of outstanding shares. That will give you the intrinsic value per share or book value per share. See, for example, here, the net worth of a company is 37 million. Net worth of a company means the share capital and reserves and surplus. And the total number of equity shares, what they have is 2 million per 2 million shares they have. So book value per share is 37 million divided by 2 million. You will get 18.5. So 18.5 is the book value per share or intrinsic value per share. So based on this, we can take a, we'll get a signal of buying the particular share or selling the particular share. So book value is a fundamental value per share. So the book value is a benchmark that the investor has got. So anything more than the book value means we call it, if it is a market value, the investor cannot have any kind of control. The market value is higher than this book value. We say the stock is overpriced. So that particular stocks we should not have in the portfolio. Those stocks we need to sell it. If the market value is less than the book value, it is underpriced. So such stocks the investors have to buy. So this kind of signal we will get by using this book value per share. So it is very simple method to calculate. It's a very objective measure of the equity shares. The major limitation is the balance sheet is based on the historical figure. It records only the historical values. It doesn't record based on the market value of the assets. So when the historical assets values are given, we cannot predict, we cannot forecast the book value per share more accurately. That's a major drawback of this particular method. Then we have, when you come down, you find the liquidation value. Yeah. So this is what the signal that I told you, what I was thinking about, intrinsic value is greater than book value, market price, we'll have to buy. IV means intrinsic value. The intrinsic value is greater than market price, we'll have to buy. The intrinsic value is less than book price, we'll have to sell. The intrinsic value is equal to market price, we need to hold these particular stock. Then the liquidation value, second measure of the balance sheet valuation. This particular method assumes that all the assets are liquidated today. What will be that value? So that's what called liquidation value. So all the assets are sold today. What is the value today? So what's the value of that asset? So that value is called the liquidation value. So for example, the company would realize 45 million from liquidation of all the assets, and the company has got 18 million to creditors and preference shareholders. And the company has got 1.5 million shares. So how do we get liquidation value per share? So 45 million is the liquidation value of all the assets, minus 18 million is the total claim of the creditors. So we have a 27 million divided by 1.5. You will get 18 million. So this particular, it is very difficult to estimate the liquidation value. So how do we estimate this liquidation value? We cannot estimate this value more accurately. There is a very important drawback of this particular method. And this particular method does not reflect earning capacity of the company. So that is another major limitation the particular value has got. The third one is the replacement cost. So the today replacement cost, what we mean here is the market value. What is the market value of the particular all the assets? So the market value is very, very difficult to predict. Okay. So based on market value, we value all the assets. So another balance sheet measure is considered by analysts in valuing the company is a replacement cost of all the assets less liabilities. So the major limitation here is how to get the market value of all the assets. That's a major limitation. We cannot get market value of the assets unless the particular asset is being sold. There's a major limitation of this particular method. And this method does not take into account the organizational capital. Organizational capital, what we mean is the contribution made by all the employees, the customers, suppliers, and even in the historical balance sheet, we don't consider this particular organizational capital. Organizational capital means contribution made by all the stakeholders of the organization. That is completely ignored in the historical balance sheet. That's another major limitation of replacement cost. Okay, this is only for theoretical aspect, not for any case study we don't have. So only for theory. So what is called replacement value? What is liquidation value? What is book value? These are all the section A questions it can be asked. Okay. So any clarification, anybody regarding this balance sheet valuation?
Sir,
Okay, so we'll move on to the second one, second model.